I always wanted a thing called a tuna sashimi. It's Super NES Works episode 23. This work brings us another console-exclusive follow-up to a classic arcade series. This one isn't quite so punishing as the last, however. Taito's Darius series kicked off in the arcades in 1986 as part of the rush to capitalize on Gradius' success. It's a horizontal shooter that fundamentally works like all the others. You control a spaceship as the screen scrolls automatically forward. You fire your main cannon forward and a secondary weapon downward, collecting upgrades along the way to boost your attack power. Taito set Darius apart with two transparently gimmicky features that, despite their obvious novelty value, helped to give the series its personality. First, the arcade cabinet was a ridiculous piece of kit that arranged three monitors together side by side to create an ultra-wide screen playfield. They used the same gimmick for Ninja Warriors, which tended to be a lot more common in US arcades than Darius, but the effect was the same. You had a lot of wasted space that you couldn't easily interact with, but it sure looked cool. Secondly, Darius gave all of its enemies an aquatic theme. All of the bosses look like giant armored sea life, ranging from tuna to seahorses to squid. The smaller enemies often repeat this motif as well, though not quite so consistently. Still, the giant mecha fishy battle, many of which were designed by Tatsunoko Productions, certainly make quite an impression. In shooters of this era, you tended to either fight enemy spacecraft or else grotesque cosmic bio-horrors. Darius splits the difference, giving players targets that are simultaneously sort of spacecraft and also kind of cosmic bio-horrors. Darius Twin is the third entry in the series and the first developed exclusively for a console. It's also, to my knowledge, the first Darius release for any Nintendo system. All of this may not come as a surprise once you actually see Darius Twin in action. This game doesn't really look like a Super NES title. It has a cleaner, sharper style than other Japanese-developed titles for the console to date. On top of that, it doesn't make use of any of Super NES's unique hardware features. There are no transparencies, no meaningful Mode 7 effects, not even multi-layered backgrounds. Indeed, the entire game looks like it would be more at home on PC Engine or Genesis than on Super NES. Even the power-up system feels like it came straight from Hudson's PC Engine shooters like Super Star Soldier. Compared to the flexible, player-driven upgrade system of Gradius 3, it's remarkably straightforward. But where the 8-bit hangover sensation of Super Ghouls and Ghosts made for a frustrating experience that demanded players start from zero to deal with its brutal challenges every single time, that approach plays a lot better here. This is a shooter, so it's naturally a pretty brief game. It offers two difficulty levels and the ability to bump up your stock of lives as high as 8. There are no continues, but you don't really need them. This is a short game that pushes players toward replay rather than toward extended sessions. But the best thing about Darius Twin's basic visual style is that it results in the smoothest action game we've yet seen on Super NES. Yeah, Taito skipped the built-in hardware features here, but they traded visual effects for slick gameplay. That's why it really looks like a PC Engine or Genesis shooter. Those consoles were known for their fast-paced shooters, and if sacrificing some graphical splendor is what it took to make that happen on Super NES, who can really complain? Anyway, Darius Twin does offer one compelling improvement over the series' previous console iterations. It's right up there in the title. It supports two-player simultaneous play, something seen in the arcade uprights, but not to this point on home systems. In terms of content, Darius Twin is pretty much exactly what you'd expect from an entry in the series that prefigures the extraordinary Darius Gaiden. You battle your way through a string of stages fighting small monsters, a mid-boss, and a giant fish robot at the end of the level. You mostly collect power-ups for your ship by defeating a specific enemy formation. 8 ships that resemble red spheres contained in wireframe cubes, which appear in arrangements of 2 parallel lines. Destroy all 8 in a group, and they'll drop one of 5 power-up icons. Red icons boost your main gun, building it up from a small energy blast to an arc of energy wider than your ship. Green upgrades your secondary weapon, taking it from a single bomb that flies forward and down from your ship to piercing lasers that fire in all 4 diagonals at once. Blue icons give you a defensive shield, orange icons function as a 1-up, and yellow icons clear the screen. There's no player choice involved in which icons drop, or the order in which you upgrade your systems, so you're basically at the mercy of the game's discretion here. In a surprising show of mercy, there's no penalty for dying in Darius Twin. If your ship is blasted out of the skies, you return to the fray sporting all the weapon upgrades you had when you died. This makes it a little kinder than Gradius 3, but on the other hand, you kind of need this clemency. Darius Twin has the least forgiving hitboxes of any of the Super NES's early shooters. If you're used to modern Danmaku shooters in which only the center few pixels of your ship are vulnerable to enemy fire or collisions, Darius Twin will be a jolt of cold water to the face. If a hazard even brushes the outer pixels of your Silverhawk, you're dead. Combine that with the speed of the action and the default life count, and you end up with a shooter that can be over in a matter of seconds if you're not careful. And even on easy difficulty, it can still be challenging. The later stages introduce plenty of threats that approach from behind without warning, forcing you to be mindful of your undefended backside. Bosses spit out lots of projectile spreads just barely wide enough for the Silverhawk to slip through, and the mid-bosses can be even more infuriating. In fact, the final stage plays up the wicked design of the mid-bosses by putting a fresh spin on the classic shooter boss gauntlet. Rather than singeing you through a parade of stage bosses one by one, Zone L pits you against multiple mid-bosses all at once for an insanely challenging prelude to the final bosses. Speaking of Zone L, that's one area in which Darius Twin does feel compromised from its predecessors. One of the series' trademarks has always been the way it offers players multiple routes to the end. At the end of each stage in a Darius game, you can choose one of two levels to tackle next, which creates a sort of branching system of stages that fan out as you advance. Here, though, the fan, such as it is, seems much more constrictive. After you beat Zone A, you can tackle either Zone B or Zone C. But whichever you choose, you always have to funnel through Zone D, Planet Lunkus. Only the fifth stage offers any real choice, with the full three stages to follow up on. But then they all funnel into two penultimate levels that lead to a single final zone. A big part of the appeal of Darius has always been in replaying the games to explore alternate routes, and Darius Twin lacks that element. The game does offer multiple endings based on performance, but there are fewer levels to explore than in most other Darius games, giving players less to do once they come to terms with the crazy mid-boss melee of Zone L and defeat the evil Great Tusk. Still, it's a pretty solid shooter. Both cooperative play and smooth, slowdown-free action are hard to come by at this point in the Super NES's life, so you can certainly see how Darius Twin had appeal. And hey, how about those bosses? Admittedly, some of them are kind of easy to cheese with a fully powered-up ship, but they all look cool. Many of them will be familiar to Darius fans, like the Zone B and C bosses, Emperor Fossil and Queen Fossil. Others reference the company's history in different ways. I'm especially fond of the Zone D boss, a mechanical squid called Demon Sword. Its name is a reference to the US title of The Legend of Kage's sequel, Fudo Muyoden, which featured the legendary Japanese sword, Shichi Shito, which the squid boss actually does somewhat resemble. All in all, it's not a bad little shooter for Super NES's early days. It's a bit simple, and probably made for a better rental than a purchase, but it showed that the console could stand toe-to-toe with Sega and NEC when it came to fast-paced action games. It just required some careful design choices. Darius Twin must have done reasonably well for Taito, since they would revisit the Darius series on Super NES a few years later with Darius Force, or as American fans know it, Supernova. But throughout the system's life, the Super NES definitely lacked for fast-paced shooters. So Darius Twin stands out, now as it did then. Next on Super NES Works, it's sports again.